Let those who are redeemed in Jesus Christ say amen. Let those who love the Lord say amen. Good morning. Merry Christmas. I need your prayers on the subject, the least of these. To be honest, it's really the runner-up to Christmas, the Advent Christmas season that I love. And despite the commercialization of Christmas, I love the carols in the shops, the street lights, the Santa Claus and their ho, ho, ho on every street, and all the general Christmas silliness like making angels and snowmen in the front and back of the yards. I love the drawing in of the night, the crisp coldness in the air, the over-decorated houses with their multicolored lights, the feel-good Christmas movies on television, and listening to the different renditions of all the Christmas songs on the radio. Putting up the trees and decorating while listening to the carols, the Christmas shopping, the variety of baked goods, cookies, cakes, turkey, yams, and hams in the shops. I love it all, church, and look forward to the Christmas decorations every year. I know that these are the very things that some people dislike about Christmas and find that it detracts from the true Christmas reality. But I am one of those who gets taken in by the decorations, by the songs, and the enjoyment that fills the air. I enjoy it all. There is something different and spiritual, magical in the air around Christmas. People feel it and give expression to it in all sorts of ways. They're longing for something other than the ordinary, for something to let them know that despite their situations, despite their needs and problems of life, there is something alive and vibrant and mysterious in the world. Expresses itself in the overdone glamour and over-the-top celebrating at Christmas time. We all long to escape the often barren, cold, the evil, the darkness of a world that is just caught up in negativity. And at Christmas, we're given free rein to let our imaginations fly and our spirits celebrate. Even for those who do not believe in Christ, Christmas is a time of goodwill and doing all the Christmas sparkle and the expectant hope of the season. Our hearts and minds are softened towards each other. We're open, our spirits warmed by the goodness of those around us. So even if many people do not celebrate Christmas in the true spirit, nor acknowledge that Jesus is the reason for the season, they nevertheless gain a glimpse of and share an experience of the love and joy that Jesus brings into our world, into our lives. The Lord makes the sun to shine on the good and the bad alike, it says in his holy word. His mercy and kindness shown in the birth of the Christ child is for all people, whether they know Jesus or not. Amen. The gift of love is offered to all at this time, and its power to change hearts and help us to find our way back to each other. It's not limited to a few, but it's open to all people, all nations, all religions. The Christmas spirit and the fun, the silliness, the songs, the carols, the gift giving and gift receiving, despite being commercialized, is a sign and a reminder that something special has happened and is happening right now. Let us know. Even when we do not acknowledge it, that our world is alive with the presence of Jesus who has come into our world. Jesus who is with us, and Jesus who comes anew in our hearts every Christmas. Yes, he is the reason for the season. The Star of Bethlehem calls to all of us. It calls us out of our secure spaces and insistently summons us to where we know not. Like the Magi of old, in wonder and faith, we follow his guiding light, leaving behind old certainties and familiar comforts. His wondrous light ignites again our youthful ideas and energize our weary faith. Oh, bless his holy name. Where does it lead us, church? No matter where it leads, that is where we are called to find the Christ child, God in our midst. And just like the Magi of old, we obediently follow until we come to an unexpected place that is not at all where we hope to find the presence of the living God. Oh, bless his holy name. And like the Magi of old, kneel in adoration at the presence of the divine amid lowliness, need, and rejection. Even in these places, the ghettos in the United States, the Fafalas in Brazil, the shanty towns of South Africa, the tunnel slums in the Philippines, God is still present, especially in these places. God is real and present. Just like the Magi of old, we open our hearts and give the gifts needed to that place where God lives. Gifts of self and love that illuminates and transforms the suffering and loneliness of those whom we find in there in that place where God dwells. The star now shines in our hearts as we rejoice at the wonder of the divine love among us, with us, and within us. We begin the story of Christmas with a sentence from scripture that's not quite true. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. Well, almost all the world, everyone who had position in society, even a working class one, like Mary and Joseph, went to be registered. Anyone who could conceivably pay taxes was on the emperor's list and had to report in and be accounted for. It was sort of the first century equivalent of Big Brother / Big Data. You're not getting anywhere in America without a driver's license. And you couldn't get anywhere in the first century Palestine without being on the emperor's list. If you were taxable, you would be counted. All went to their own towns to be registered. Luke says, well, again, not quite all. Luke himself tells us that in the next paragraph. In that region where shepherds lived in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night, the shepherds did not return to their hometowns to be registered. They were on the very bottom rung of society. Church, they couldn't pay taxes and had fallen so far between the cracks of the Roman Empire that they weren't even expected to. They were nobodies. And when it came for the registration to show up and present their names and papers to the government, no one looked for them. They quite literally didn't count. And who among all the people in the Bible were the first to hear the news of the birth of Christ? While everyone else was in the city, busily submitting to TSA screenings and handling and their forms at the DMV and making sure their health insurance card was in their wallet, the shepherds were out in the country with their sheep. They were not worried about whether there would be room at the inn. The inn was never an option for them. And out of this violent and dangerous world of oppression and Roman occupation comes something earth-shattering. Then the angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. Suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom God favors." Why are we always surprised that it is the less and the lost and the least to whom God brings the good news first? The people were rejected and scorned and abandoned, people on whom society relied for manual labor and to endure the dangers of scaring off predators from the sheep, saw the heavenly hosts and the glory of the Lord. Oh, bless his holy name. David was a shepherd who became a king, and so was Jesus. But where David stayed a king, Jesus' identity as the good shepherd was always more important to him than any regal crown or royal rule. To the least of these, which one of you having 100 sheep and losing one of them does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? Jesus says later in the Gospel of Luke, shepherds know what counts, and that is counting every sheep, making sure every single one is safe and home and cared for, no matter how wayward and stubborn. To the Roman Empire, the shepherds didn't count, but to God, they did. And to Jesus, they did. To the point that he took on their name and their ministry, calling himself the Good Shepherd. I'm saying to the least of these. Why did he do that? Perhaps in gratitude for their neck actions in the story. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. And when they saw this, church, they made known what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told to them. Imagine what it would feel like to be told by society and the government for your whole life that you don't count, you don't matter, you aren't even worth the trouble to write down your name on a list so you can pay taxes. And then imagine being told by the very heavenly host that you do count in a much bigger world, the kingdom of God. I'm telling you, to the least of these. The shepherds could have stayed in the fields with the sheep. They knew their territory. They had a job to do there. They knew they weren't welcome in the city anyway, but they had both the raw courage and the profound generosity to share the good news, the message, with people who had never valued them. That is grace. That is joy. That is being an evangelist. That is evangelization. That is a life transformed by the gospel. To the least of these, who do you dislike because you don't know they don't value you? To whom do you feel like a number and not a name? Are there people in your life who dismisses you because of your age, your color, the home you live in, the country of your birth, the work you do, or the person you love? Who makes you feel like you don't count? That may be the very person whose soul is starving for want of the good news. That may be the very person who is so trapped by a system, an evil system, that lends them status and importance that they could not imagine what it means to be loved without labels. That may be the person who needs you, a messenger of God, the most. There are people in your life right now who do not know that God loves them, cares for them, that God sees them. I'm talking about to the least of these. There are people in your life right now who think they don't count. Someone must tell them they do matter, that God loved them, and you are that person. Maybe that's a scary idea. It seems like hard work, or you would like to think it's someone else's job. Maybe you're the one who feels like you don't count. Maybe you're the one for whom the love of God is more a nice idea than the real experience, a spiritual awakening, a relationship with Jesus Christ. Either way, you're a shepherd. You are abiding in the fields, and the heavenly host has something to say to you this Christmas. Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. Here's the message of Christmas, and write it on your heart. You count. You matter. You are important. You're the one to the least of these. God is so in love with you that God sent God's only Son to live and dwell among you, to teach you, to heal you, to die for you, to rise for you. And the deeper you take that knowledge into you, the freer and braver you are to tell that to every single person you meet. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered, except for the shepherds, because they had nothing that the empire could use. They were of no value to Rome, the political oppressor, or Rome, the economic juggernaut. They didn't count. Does it sound familiar, church, to the least of these? Find the ways you don't count to political oppressors and economic juggernauts. Find the ways you can't fit in as a cog in the machine because your light is too bright and your shape is too strange and your life is too real. That is where God loves you the most. You count. You matter. God proclaims that today to the whole universe in the birth of Christ Jesus. Don't ever forget it to the least of these. The kingdom of God needs you. The Lord makes the sun to shine on the good and bad alike. His mercy and kindness shown in the birth of the child Jesus is for all people, whether they know him or not. The Bible is different. Stories, just simple little stories. Jesus never explains anything. He says proverbs and stories. He entices the imagination. No explanation are necessary. In stories, you accept the story. And the truth is not in explaining the story. It is receiving the story into your own heart. I think probably this Christmas, very few of you are as old as I am. But I can remember my favorite Christmas story. I'm sure you must have seen it because it's repeated again and again on television during Christmas time. It's the story of the little match girl. It's a sentimental story, but underlying it is a great, great truth. And as the story goes, it's New York City. It's a terrible winter day. And there's this little girl, barefoot, looking real, you know, just, you know, really bad, her shoes, her coat is all torn. And she's front of a nightclub and there's, some matches. And that's why she's the little match girl, because she sells matches for a living. Her father died many years before. Her mother was a lovely lady, but she got tuberculosis. which was quite common in New York at that time, and she too passed away. And so we have the little match girl in front of the nightclub with all very important people going in and out of the club. And it begins to snow, and as the snow deepens, she gets colder and colder, but no one is paying attention to the little girl. They're busy about going in and out of the club, celebrating. It's Christmas Eve, and they're celebrating Christmas Day. And so it is that she remembers her mother saying, "Someday I will take you home." She begins to realize that she's quite cold. So what she does, she lights her own little matches, one by one, just to keep warm as the snow comes down. And then after a while, box after box, she comes to the very end of the matches. And the last match, there's a glare and a glow from it, unlike the other matches. And she seems as if she's falling asleep. But there is a great light, and the lovely woman in blue comes down and takes her by the hand and leads her up where her mother waits for her. And of course, after the party is over, the people come out, and what do they see? A ring of burnout matches and the little girl who has died. But they do not hear the angels sing, and they do not understand that her mother, true to her word, said, "I will send someone to bring you safely home." And that is where the story ends. It's a lovely story, and I'm sure you will hear it again and again. What is the great underlying truth in this? Jesus too came like the poor match girl. He came and was born in poverty. His mother Mary was maybe 15 or 16 years old. She was not married, pregnant, came 100 miles down from the tip of Galilee all the way to the little village of Bethlehem. A terrible trial, and even more so for Joseph, who stumbled along day after day. And they finally made their way to Bethlehem. And then suddenly her time had come, and the child was born. Stay with me, church. Where does this place the child? You would think if it's God's child, the whole world was cheering. But no, 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 no. No place to lay the child. And finally, a brother in the hood, a friendly stranger, brings them to a cave. And in the cave, there are animals. And there's the child is born and laid in a manger. The awesomeness of God, the wonder of it, God sending us his only begotten son. God, who cannot afford to give his son even a decent little place to be born in. God cannot even afford to take care of his own son. We wonder at it, and we think of it. And years later, we begin to understand that the child had come this way because the kingdom of God belongs to all children, all nations, the total universe. And so it is that Joseph is very important, for he will be the father of the child and take care of him. And Mary, the mother, is important because it is in the arms of Mary that the child will live and have a home. And God was saying to us the thing that all children understand, that a child is in the heart, dependent on others to survive. And Jesus later preached the great doctrine that no matter who you are, how rich you think you are, how famous you might want to become, what defines a child is that they know their need for God. And in knowing their need for God, they reach out in faith and give God the totality of their lives. And that is what the story of a little match girl tells us. That God is not relying upon us human beings to take care of the whole world. The times like the little match girl where he intervenes and brings her safely home. Because the nice little girl, she always listened to her mother who said, "God will never desert you and you will come safely home." For Jesus says, unless you become a little child, you'll never, never know what the love of the kingdom is all about. You count. You matter. God proclaims that today to the whole universe in the birth of the child Jesus. Don't ever forget it. The kingdom of God needs you. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas.